हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग ग्रेट। आई सीए पुजिन कपाड़िया वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन माय टुडेज लेक्चर ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट एडवांस अकाउंटिंग एंड ऑडिटिंग 5। फ्रेंड्स, इन द अर्लियर लेक्चर वी हैव कवर्ड द टॉपिक ऑफ इंट्रोडक्शन ऑन ऑडिटिंग, अंडर व्हिच वी हैव स्टडीड फ्रॉम वेयर वी हैव डिराइव्ड द वर्ड ऑडिट। पोस्ट दैट वी हैव स्टडीड व्हाट इज द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ऑडिट, देन स्कोप ऑफ ऑडिट. Then we have studied four important words like what is bookkeeping, what is auditing, what is accounting, and what is investigation. After which we have decided and studied the difference between what is accountancy and what is auditing, a detailed discussion on the difference. After which we have studied advantages and limitations of auditing. This was the entire first chapter that we have covered, was introduction to auditing. Today we are going to start with a new topic. The name of the topic, as it read on the slide, is Objectives of Audit. Why we are supposed to do audit? What is the main purpose behind doing an audit? What is the goal of doing an audit? We are going to cover this entire thing in today's lecture. So, starting with the first part. A, principle or the main objective. Just to give you the brief idea, the entire objectives of audit are broadly divided into three different categories, that is primary objectives, subsidiary objectives, and other objectives. So we are going to start with the first one, that is principal objectives or main objectives. The first point or the main first objective is to verify that the accounts are written correctly. See, it may sound a shorter statement, but if we try to interpret the same, it has a broader meaning. What is written over here is, I need to verify that all the accounts are written correctly. Now, correctly is a word which has so many things within it. First of all, I am supposed to check whether all the accounts are arithmetically correct or not. Secondly, I need to check whether all the accounts are written as per the current accounting principles or not. Thirdly, I need to check whether the accounts are written as per the statutory requirement, as per the legal requirements that are prevalent in our country. In short, I am going to verify whether all the accounts are written correctly. That is my primary or the first objective. Second principal objective, which I have discussed in detail in the earlier lectures, is to check that true and fair view of the financial statements. I need to assure that whether my balance sheet is showing true and fair view of the financial position of the business. I need to assure that whether my profit and loss account is showing true and fair view of the profitability of the business. I hope till now you are totally clear with what is true and fair view. So, to crux or to short it, cut it down, I would like to say that the principle or the main objectives of the auditors, first is to verify that whether all the accounts are written correctly or not, and second is to assure that whether the financial statements show true and fair view or not. These are the principal or the main objectives of audit. Moving ahead to the second part, that is subsidiary or incidental objects, that is the secondary objects. Fine. In that, the first point is detection and prevention of errors. Important word over here is errors. Fine. So what we are going to do as a subsidiary objective is to identify, to detect, and to prevent the occurrence of the errors. Now in this topic, I'm going to take you back in your 11th standard where you have studied a chapter, types of errors and rectification of errors. There are different types of errors I'm going to discuss, which will be coming in the next slide. We are going to discuss errors of omission, errors of commission, clerical errors, errors of principle, and compensating errors. As of now, I am not going in detail because we are going to deal with the same topic in the upcoming slide. Second purpose or the second objective under the head of subsidiary objective is detection and prevention of frauds. See, first was errors, this is frauds. Now the question is, what is the basic difference between what is error and what is fraud? To keep it's simple, I would say error is something which may not be intentional, while fraud is something which is intentional. This is a general difference so that we can understand the topic in a better manner. In fraud, there are basically three different kinds of fraud that we are going to study in detail. First is embezzlement of cash, that is misappropriation of cash. For example, I am having actual cash, physical cash balance of rupees 1 lakh, but I want to show less cash on my hand. I am taking that cash at my home. So this is nothing. This is known as misappropriation of cash. Accountant knows that there is a cash balance of 1 lakh rupees in the account. What he's doing is he is showing only 50,000 on books and taking another 50,000 rupees at his own place. This is nothing. This is the embezzlement of cash. Second point is misappropriation of goods. I know there is a stock of 1000 kg at my business premises. What I'm doing is I'm taking 1 kg at my home. So I'm showing only 999 kgs on books. This is misappropriation of goods. And last is manipulation of accounts. Manipulation of accounts basically means if you want to show less profit or if you want to show more profits, what are the accounting tactics that you are supposed to going to do? So basically, in the heading of fraud, we are going to cover three different kinds of frauds. One, which is related to cash. Second, which is related to goods. And third, which is related to manipulation of accounts. We are going to study in detail how this fraud occurs, how we can detect and control the same. So in this particular chapter, that is the objects of audit, major focus is going to be on five different kind of errors and three different kind of frauds. I hope I'm clear till here. First is principal objective, which covers two important points. One is whether to verify whether all the accounts are maintained in a correct manner or written correctly or not. Second is to ensure whether my financial statements show true and fair view. Second is subsidiary objectives, in which we are going to deal with detection and prevention of errors and detection and prevention of frauds. Moving ahead to the other objectives. First is moral check on employees. I have already discussed the same in the last lecture in the topic of advantages of auditing. If you know that your work is going to be cross-checked by someone else, then you are going to do that work in a more proper manner, in a more accurate and precise manner, because you know you don't want to leave any chance of mistake. As a result of which, auditing is something which is going to imply moral check on the employees. Second is comply with the requirements of the Companies Act 2013. As I told you guys, that if I am going to audit any of the companies, I need to see that all the provisions, all the regulations of Companies Act 2013 are being duly followed with. Third is to create a trust in government official. Example, Income Tax Department. As I discussed in the last lecture, that if you are presenting audited financial information, the reliability, the trustworthiness of your financial information automatically increases. Any authority, it may be any government official like Income Tax Department, are going to trust audited financial information much more than the unaudited financial information. So these are the other objectives that we are going to deal with. I hope I'm clear. So the entire objectives or the objects of audit are broadly classified into three types. First is principal objectives, under head of which we studied 2 points, correctness of accounts and true and fair view. Second was subsidiary objectives, again under which we studied 2 points, errors and fraud. And the third was other objectives, in which we have seen moral check on employees, complying with the provisions of Companies Act. And third was creating trust in the government official. Now let's start with the types of errors. We have just read in the previous slide, there are 5 kinds of errors that we are going to deal with. This is nothing. This is the same repetition that you have studied in Accountancy Standard 11. But I assume that you might be knowing the same, but let's refresh the entire topic. And there can be a 2-mark question which may be asked from this topic. So I'll just like to let you know, let's study and prepare it once and for all along with me as of now. The first error that we are going to study is error of omission. That is, the transactions go unrecorded. Let's take an example. I have purchased a laptop of rupees 70,000. I forgot to record this entry in the books of account. This kind of error is known as error of omission, that you are not recording the transaction in the books of accounts. Second is errors of commission. Transactions are recorded or they are posted, but they are recorded or posted wrongly. For example, if I have purchased a laptop of rupees 70,000, I have recorded in the books of account that I have purchased the laptop. But what I have recorded, the amount instead of 70,000, I have written 60,000. This is nothing. This is the error of commission. Or I have shown that purchase of laptop of rupees 70,000, but instead of debiting it on the asset side, what I have done is I have credited. So either I have recorded it wrongly or I have posted it wrongly. Such kind of errors are known as error of commission. That is, any mistake in recording or mistake in posting. Third, errors of principle. Transactions not recorded as per the fundamental accounting principles. I am recording the transaction, but I am not following the accounting principle at the time of writing that particular transaction. For example, I have written over here, I have purchased a machine. Fine. I have purchased the machine. But what I have done is, I have recorded the amount of machine in the purchase account. You very well know, if we are buying a machine, we are showing it in a machinery account on the asset side. We are not showing it in a purchase account in trading account. So this is nothing. This is the error of principle. You might be aware, when we purchase a machine, there are certain installation charges that we pay to start up a machine. These installation charges are not debited to wages account. Where they are debited, they are added to the cost of machinery. So again, if I'm showing the installation wages as wages expenses, it is fundamentally wrong. I am doing an error of principle. So the third point that we have covered is errors of principle. I'll just repeat all the three points so you can get a clear idea about the same. First was error of omission. I am doing a transaction, but I'm not recording the transaction in my books of account. For example, I bought a laptop of rupees 70,000, but I have not recorded its entry in my books of account. Second is errors of commission. That is, I am recording the transaction or I'm posting the transaction, but I'm doing it wrongly. In which I gave you the example, I have recorded the entry of purchase of laptop, but instead of 70,000, what I have written, 60,000. Or I have written it as 70,000, but instead of writing it on a debit side, what I have done is I have recorded on a credit side. Third is error of principle. That is, you are not complying with the fundamental accounting principles. For example, I have purchased the machinery. Instead of debiting machinery account, I have debited purchase account. If I have purchased the machinery and have paid installation charges, installation wages for the same, instead of adding it to the cost of machinery, I have debited wages account, which is actually wrong. Next point is compensating errors. We used to learn this definition in accountancy. What is it? Let's see it. The amount of errors committed on a debit and credit side being equal are cancelled against each other and the trial balance tallies. What is it? I'll just try to explain it in a simpler way. What I'm doing is, I'm conducting two kind of errors. There are two errors that I have done. Now, both the errors are such that one is having an effect on debit side, one is having the effect on credit side. For example, that I have written over here is, I have unrecorded purchases of rupees 100. That is, I have purchased in actual, in reality, but I failed to record it in my books of account. So what will be the final outcome of this? My debit side will be less by 100 rupees, right? In the same way, I have received the income of rupees 100, but I have not recorded it in the books of accounts. So by this, what will happen is my credit side will be shown less by rupees 100. Now I have done two errors of omission over here. One is unrecording purchase by 100 rupees. So debit side will be less by 100 rupees. Unrecording income. So credit side will be less by rupees 100. In short, I have done two mistakes in such a manner that my debit and credit total gets tallied. Such kind of errors are known as compensating errors. I hope I am clear with this concept. So compensating errors are such errors due to which trial balance is not affected at all, because the debit error is directly offsetting the credit error. The last part is clerical errors. That is all the other kind of error. Let's see it once again. What is it? First point is omission to post to an account. That is, you have not posted to any particular account. Second is posting on the wrong side of account. Like, you need to be debited, but what you have done is you have credited that account. Next is posting wrong amount to an account. You have posted it on the right side, but by a wrong account, amount in that account. Fourth is double posting. Like I have purchased machinery of ₹10,000. I have passed it entry for 2 times. Again, it is an error. Next is mistake in totaling the subsidiary books. The total of purchase book is 10,000. I have written it as a 11,000. Next is finding out wrong balance of account. What I have done is at the time of balancing the ledger, total of credit side was 1 lakh rupees. Total of debit side was 60,000 rupees. So the balance should be 40,000. But I have written 30,000 by mistake. Again, it is an error. And last is carrying forward wrong balance of an account. I have find out correctly 1 lakh minus 60,000 is 40,000. But while carrying forward the balance to the next year, instead of writing 40,000, I have written 30,000. In short, these are the all other clerical errors that may happen in the course of your accounting. I'll just give you 1 or 2 minutes and would request you to go through all the types of errors that I have mentioned over here. Well, friends, I hope you have gone through the entire types of errors. Error of omission, that is not recording the entry. Error of commission, that is you are recording or posting, but you are doing it wrongly. Error of principle, you are not following the fundamental accounting principle. Compensating error, you have done 2 errors, but the debit error is offsetting the credit error. And last is all the other kind of clerical errors. Moving ahead, we have 2 types of errors. Errors which affect the trial balance, errors which not affect the trial balance. Let's see which are the errors that are affecting trial balance. The entire list that I have written over here is the same as we have studied in clerical errors. All the points are the same, so I am not repeating it again. Moving ahead, writing incorrect balance in the trial balance. For example, the balance of my capital account was ₹1 lakh. But at the time of taking the balance from the ledger account to my trial balance, I have recorded mistakenly as 1,10,000. So what I'm doing is I am writing an incorrect balance in my trial balance, which is again an error, as a result of which my credit side will be more than 10,000 because I need to have shown 1 lakh rupees. But what I'm showing is 1,10,000 rupees. Next is writing balance on a wrong side of the trial balance. For example, the balance of capital account was ₹1 lakh, which was supposed to be written on the credit side of trial balance. What I'm doing is I'm writing on a debit side of trial balance. What will be the outcome of this is my credit side will be less by 2 lakh rupees. One is 1 lakh jo dikhana tha, wo nahi dikhaya. Aur 1 lakh jo mujhe credit side pe dikhana tha, wo maine kya kar diya? Debit side pe dikha diya. As a result of which, will there be the difference of double, that is 2 lakh rupees. So this all are the errors which are affecting the trial balance. Now let's take a look at the errors which are not affecting the trial balance. First is error of omission. I have entered into a transaction, but I have not recorded it in the books of accounts. For example, purchase laptop in cash of ₹70,000. So the entry would be laptop account debit to cash account 70,000, 70,000. Now if I am not recording it at all, so what I will be doing is I have not given debit effect of 70,000. I have not given the credit effect of 70,000. As a result of which, trial balance is not going to be affected by this particular time of error. So error of omission is something which is not going to affect your trial balance. Second is error of principle. In our example, the installation cost of machinery needs to be debited to machinery account. But what I have done, I have debited to wages account. So let's take an example. This charges was 10,000 rupees. So I have to debit machinery account by 10,000, but instead what I have done, I have debited wages account by 10,000. Trial balance do not check which account is debited. What does it check is, there should be a proper debit and a proper credit. So debit hona tha 10,000 ka, wo to hua hi hai. So basically there is no error which is affecting trial balance. So again, error of principle is not affecting your trial balance. Third is compensating errors that we have already discussed, that debit error is going to offset the credit error. As the errors are offset by each other, it is not going to affect your trial balance. Next is errors committed while writing the books of original entry. That is, when you are recording the transaction for the first time in your general, fine, if you are committing any error at that particular point of time, it is not going to affect your trial balance. For example, I have purchased a laptop of ₹70,000 in cash. My entry should be laptop account debit to cash account, 70,000, 70,000. Now what I have done over here, instead of writing 70,000, I have written 35,000. Now the entire effect will be, debit side is recorded by 35,000, lesser amount. Credit side is also recorded by 35,000, lesser amount. But at the end, my trial balance is going to get tallied, because debit side 35,000 less, credit side 35,000 less. Both will be offsetting each other. So if I am doing any error at the time of passing entry in general, it is not going to affect my trial balance. And the last part is posting of correct amount on correct side but wrong ledger. I am writing on a correct side. Matlab jo debit hona tha, maine debit hi kiya hai with the correct amount. 70,000 likhna tha, 70,000 hi likhna hai. But instead of debiting to laptop account, I have debited to machinery account. Now this is not going to affect your trial balance, because there is no arithmetical mistake in this. There is a ledger account mistake in this. So again, this is not going to affect your trial balance. See, this is the entire repetition what you have studied in 11th standard accounts. But since it is a part of your syllables, I am directly going through all these points once again. Fine. I hope I am clear. Again, giving you 1 minute. Just take a quick look to the errors which are affecting trial balance and the errors which are not affecting the trial balance. Well, I hope you have gone through both the things, that is errors affecting trial balance and errors not affecting trial balance. Let's come to the last part for the today's lecture, that is detection of errors when the trial balance do not tally. See, if the trial balance tally, it is quite difficult to find out the actual error. But when we know that the trial balance is not telling, that is debit side, that is total of debit side, and the total of credit side is mismatching, what we can do to detect, to find out that kind of errors. The first and the, I can say, traditional way to find out this error is re-examination of trial balance. Means I am going to see each and everything once again. First point is, I need to re-examine balances of all the ledger accounts are correctly recorded. That is, jiska jo balance hona chahiye tha, I need to ensure that everything is recorded in a correct manner. Second is, I need to check that the account balances are recorded on the correct side. If the capital account is having credit balance, it should be recorded on a credit side of a trial balance. So I need to check it for each and every account once again. Third is, ensure that no ledgers are left out to be recorded. I am preparing ledger account. I need to check that I have transferred entry of balances of each and every ledger account to the trial balance. So there should not be a single ledger account which goes unrecorded. So this is something, a traditional process I'm going to do each and everything once again, and I'm going to re-examine my trial balance. What is the second thing that we can do? If I doubt that there are some mistakes in the ledger itself at the time of preparing the ledgers, what I can do is I can check the ledgers. First point, ensure correct entry of opening balances. I need to check the balance carried forward and the balance brought forward for all the ledger accounts should match. It should not be like that. The closing balance of last year was rupees 1 lakh rupees. At the time of bringing it forward to this current year, it came as 1,10,000. So I need to check first of all that the closing balance of last year are matching with the opening balance of the current year. Second thing what I can check is I have properly calculated the closing balances. That is, whenever I'm finding out the balances, like if I'm finding the total of credit side minus total of debit side, I need to check the calculations are done correctly. There should not be any mistake in this particular calculation. Third is checking posting of every entry. For example, I have purchased the laptop for cash, laptop account debit 70,000, cash account credit 70,000. When I'm recording this entry or posting this entry in the ledger of laptop account, I need to ensure that I am writing on a debit side to cash account in the amount column, I should have written 70,000 rupees. So what I'm going to do over here is I'm going to check the posting, whether I have done each and every posting from the primary or the original books of account like general or subsidiary books to my ledger account. So this is a step ahead. In the first point, we were checking or examining the trial balance from the beginning. In the second point, what we are doing, we are checking each and everything in the ledger itself. Still, if you are having the doubt, still if you are not able to find the error, what you are going to do is you are going to more detailed examination. That is a third point, checking cash book and subsidiary book. Matlab, jahan se hum recording start karte, we are going to touch that point. We need to check that the balance carried forward to be verified properly. So in short, at the time of detecting the error, when the trial balance do not tally, first of all, we are going to re-examine the trial balance. Still, if we are not getting our error, we are going to check the ledgers. Still, if we are not getting the errors, what we are going to do? We are going to check the cash book and the subsidiary books. There are two practical techniques that I have practically seen at the time of conducting audit of any of the company. It shows us if difference on the two sides should be divided by two and check for the resultant figure. See, this is something which we have done, we have practiced and we have observed that sometimes kehte hai na, tukka lag jata hai. Bas yehi cheez hai. In this particular thing, if the difference of the two sides, for example, debit side is 1 lakh rupees and credit side ka total is 1,50,000 rupees. What I have to do is, I need to take the difference, that is 50,000. I need to divide it by 2, that is 25,000. I am going to check that if any entry of rupees 25,000 is posted or recorded wrongly, because there are fair chances to get answer by this way. This is nothing. This is the reverse trial and error technique that we are going to try. So what we have learned in this particular point, you need to find the difference of the two sides, that is debit side and credit side. You are going to divide this difference by 2 and you are going to check for that particular figure. Second thing, again like this only, if difference between two sides is divisible by 9, I hope you understand what is divisible by 9. Like it is like difference is 9, 18, 27 and so on and so forth. If it is divisible by 9, then the figures might be wrongly placed. Let's understand this. If I have to write 25 as the correct amount, but what I have done is by mistake, I have written 52 instead of 25. Let's find out the difference. What is it? 52 minus 25. The difference is 27. Is 27 divisible by 9? Answer is yes, it is divisible by 9. Then there are fair chances that there can be the mistake of interplacing the digits of the amount. Again, I am telling, this is not a golden rule that you can apply to each and everything. But sometimes it becomes very tedious or difficult to find out the errors from the trial balance. So these are general trial and error tactics that you can work on, by which, by fluke, you can get certain answers to this particular differences. I hope I am clear with this topic, how to find out or detect the errors when the trial balance do not tally. First of all, the most easiest thing, what we are going to do is, we are going to re-examine the trial balance. If still we are not getting our answer, what we are going to do, we are going to check each and every ledger. If still we are not getting our error, we are going to the origin, that is to the primary books of accounts, and going to find our errors. These are the two different techniques that I have used over here. find out or calculate the difference, divide the same by 2 and find for that figure. Second is, if your difference is divisible by 9, there are fair chances that you have interchanged the digits of your total amount. Fine. So today, what we have studied till now is, first of all, we have started with the objects of audit. Fine. In which we have studied principal or primary objective, which was to verify the accounts are written correctly or showing true and fair view. Second was subsidiary objectives, in which we have studied errors and fraud detection and prevention. Third was others, which included moral check on employees, requirement are complied for Companies Act, and last was increasing the trust in the government officials. Then we studied what are the types of errors. We studied errors which affect trial balance, which do not affect trial balance. And last is how to detect these errors. Now it's a time to check how much you have retained from today's lecture. The technique goes same, 25 to 30 seconds per question. Mark your answers during this time. After discussing all the 5 MCQs, we are going to discuss the correct answer. So I guess you are ready and your time starts now. Well, friends, I hope you are ready with your answers. So let's check whether you have done it correctly or not. The first question was, the primary objective of audit do not include. We have studied in the very first slide, the primary objective includes two things. First is verifying the correctness of accounts, and second is verifying truth and fairness of accounts. So C option, that is finding errors or fraud, is the correct answer of this question, because it is not included in the primary objective. It is your subsidiary or the incidental objective. Question number 2, which of the following error affects trial balance? Correct answer is option D, error of double posting. The same example, if I purchase laptop for cash of rupees 70,000, I have written in general, laptop account debit to cash account 70,000, 70,000. But at the time of posting in laptop account, if I'm writing the same entry twice, that I'm debiting laptop account for 2 times, then instead of 70,000, what I'm showing debit side by 140,000. So this is the error which is going to affect the trial balance. Rest of the errors are not going to affect the trial balance. Third is, wages for installation of machinery is recorded in wages account. We know if we are paying wages for installation of machinery, they are supposed to be debited to machinery account and not to wages account. So here we have not followed the fundamental accounting principle. So such errors are known as error of principle. So the correct answer is B, error of principle. Fourth point, complying with the provisions of Companies Act 2013 is dash type of objective. We have referred this in the third category, that is others. Fine. So the correct answer is C, others. Last is purchase of rupees 100 and rent income received of rupees 100 left unrecorded. Purchase is basically shown on the debit side. I have not recorded debit side by rupees 100. Rent income received is shown on credit side. I am not recording rupees 100 on credit side. So the error on debit side is offsetting the error on credit side. What is it? It is the compensating errors. So the correct answer is option C. I hope you might have got all the answers correctly. With this, I'd like to end for today's lecture. I thank you all for your patient listening and I wish you all the best and to gain a proper knowledge of all the topics that we have studied today. Thank you, friends.